Oke, bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Alhamdulillah rabbil alamin wassalatu wassalamu ala sayidina asyrafil anbiya wal mursalin wa ala alihi wa sahbihi ajmain. So, alhamdulillah, thank you for coming for attending this session, this book reading session. This is actually a regular reading session, reading session of sessions of almarhum Prof Kamal's books. So for today, insyaAllah, we will continue to read the book on Wasatiyah. Now we are already in chapter 3. The title of the book is The Voice, His Voice of Islamic Moderation from the Malay World by Almarhum Prof. Kamal Hassan, which was published in 2011. It was published in 2011. As mentioned in previous sessions, actually the book is actually a combination, a compilation of articles written by Almarhum Prof, especially during the 9/11 event. So the articles actually were trying to address the phenomenon that happened after the tragic event. All right. So again, Almarhum Prof, he mentions in the earlier part of the book that the book is dedicated to not only Muslim, but also not only Muslims, but also non-Muslims worldwide. So the book, the way it was written to suit the audience from different religions, not only for Muslims but also for non-Muslims. Okay, so again, usually as practice, we will read word by word of the book, and I will then try my best to contemplate, all right, from my limited knowledge. By the way, I'm Zahid, I'm from Centris, and I'm also, my specialization is in political science, particularly in political thought, political theory. So therefore, my contemplation will be much from that perspective. So I may be lacking in terms of historical perspective, perhaps in terms of the Islamic legal code perspectives. So all of you are welcome to add anything that you think that you also can contemplate on from your own point of view. You are most welcome from the administrative perspective, perhaps. Yes, I've seen here there's many, a few from administrative staff. Thank you very much. Again, Almarhum Prof always, he dedicated his writings not only to academics, but to all, okay, to everyone, okay, especially Muslims. All right, so today I'm going to continue reading the third chapter, chapter 3. Now we are here. Creating a caring ummah, transforming the response. Why the word, the title is start there? Okay. Maybe it is somewhere. Why the title has start? Okay, I will try to look at the reference section. It is quite a long chapter, so therefore today, inshallah, we will not finish the whole chapter, but we will try our best to at least cover a few sub-chapters. Oh, okay. Lecture delivered at the second International Muslim Leaders Consultation on HIV 08 in Kuala Lumpur, 19 to 23rd May 2003. So this is actually his lecture, okay, almarhum lecture, which delivered at this event on HIV. All right. It is interesting because previously we didn't discuss about HIV. He didn't write on HIV for the previous chapters. So today, I think it is about HIV. Okay. Introduction. One of the humbling facts of contemporary history is that the Muslim Ummah continues to suffer from a multitude of crises and social ailments, which have resulted in making some poor Muslim countries more dependent upon international assistance and technological advancements from non-Muslim countries are the high incidence of drug abuse and the spread of HIV or AIDS. So here, excuse me, I'm a bit under the weather, okay, coughing a bit, please bear with me. So one of the humbling facts of our history, okay, the Muslim Ummah history, is that we continue to suffer from different numerous crises, which have resulted us to be poor, meaning to say the Muslim countries, and we are dependent upon international assistance and technological advancement from non-Muslim countries. Yeah, that's true, right? So almarhum Prof started with this fact that we Muslims, we always dependent upon non-Muslim countries because we are poor, and therefore we are not advanced in terms of technology, so we always learn from them, particularly when it comes to the question, the problem of HIV. Many Muslim leaders and governments have expressed their concern and fears over these epidemics, which are by no means confined to Muslim countries, but the inadequacy of response from Muslim masses and groups to the problem of HIV or AIDS in particular is a legitimate cause of worry. Okay? So, almarhum Prof, he expresses his concern here about these epidemics, which are not only confined to Muslim countries. Yes, he accepted that, but the issue here is the inadequacy of our response to this problem. Okay, are we dealing with it correctly? Ignorance about the disease and psychological factors may be some of the reasons for the poor lack of appropriate response to the new social ailment. Yes, at that moment, it can be considered as a new. I think, as far as I'm concerned, HIV started to emerge in the 70s. Okay, please correct me if I'm wrong. With greater exposure, understanding, and education regarding HIV or AIDS, a more proactive attitude would be forthcoming from Muslim NGOs, religious leaders, and intellectuals. All right, so intellectuals, religious leaders, Muslim NGOs should address this crucial issue. The United Nations Security Council declared in June 2000 that HIV was no longer just a health issue, and if unchecked, would likely pose a major threat, open quote, major threat to stability and human security, close quote. Many countries have been devastated, families and communities have been decimated, and lives of hundreds of millions of people have been adversely affected by HIV or AIDS. According to Peter R. Lamptey, who works with Family Health International on HIV, AIDS prevention and care programs in more than 60 of the world's poorest countries. Oh, so this is the person who work with the Family Health International on HIV in different countries, 60 of the world's poorest countries. Okay, this is his quote. By the end of 2001, an estimated 65 million people worldwide had been infected with HIV. 2001, now it's 2024. 25 million had died, and 40 million were living with HIV or AIDS, most of whom have no access to the life-saving drugs available in industrialized countries. All right, again, the question of technology. Poor countries, we do not have advanced technology to curb this, okay, to not to cure, but at least to at least to curb the problems. It is estimated by Gerald J. Stein, a professor at the University of North Florida, USA, that while 95% of the cases are concentrated in developing countries, so it is highlighted here by Almarhum Prof, the words of Gerald J. Stein, the professor at the University of Florida, North Florida, 95% of the cases are concentrated in developing countries. Meaning to say, not in advanced countries, but in developing countries. Industrialized countries are experiencing about 90,000 new infections each year, ending 2002. About 27 million people will have died from AIDS. All right? So quite a lot. To him, AIDS is a war that no one wants to lose, but no one yet knows how to win. Because until today, we do not have the cure for AIDS as far as I'm concerned. Again, I'm not an expert in medicine, but based on my limited knowledge, now they have that pre-exposure prophylaxis pills, or they call it as PrEP. It is quite a controversial pills here. It can reduce the possibility, but the technology, I think, only appeared lately, okay, not in 2002. Okay, so perhaps during this moment when Almarhum Prof wrote this article, PrEP was not there. Okay. The 14th International AIDS Conference held in Barcelona from July 7 to 12 July 2002 was informed by researchers that, again in 2002, okay, unless effective methods of preventing the spread of the disease are quickly put in place, another 45 million people will become infected within the next 8 years. So it is expected that in 2010, 45 million people more will be infected. Some 29 million of those new cases would be prevented through better education about HIV. The prevalence of HIV in the worst affected countries is growing faster than was previously believed possible. So it is increasing. Right, I wonder why in this chapter almarhum Prof talks about HIV, because previously in the previous chapters we read about the importance of religions. Religions. If you, some of you perhaps you attended the previous sessions. In chapter 2 and chapter 1, almarhum Prof, he talked about the importance of religions to combat, okay, the problems created by globalization, global capitalist market economy. So for him, he argues that at least we come back to religion, no matter what kind of religion that you believe in, maybe Buddhism, maybe Hinduism, because for him, at least religions can curb the problems created by secularism, right? Or atheism. But again, I think I mentioned many times that almarhum Prof, he was not a perennial scholar, as we know him that he is not a perennial scholar. Okay, he didn't say that all religions will go to the same place the hereafter, right? But now he started to talk about HIV, so maybe we will find the connecting point afterwards. It was predicted in the UN report that, open quote, unless there is a massive increase in prevention and treatment, 68 million people will die of AIDS in the 45 most affected countries between 2000 and 2022. So if this is true, then 68 million already passed away because of AIDS. It is indeed alarming that 11.3% of the almarhum Prof, he quotes a lot of numbers here. The 15,000 new infections occurring every day are in children below 15 years of age, and that women now represented 47% of all infected adults. So, yes, children also affected. In Malaysia, the first AIDS case was discovered in 1806. Yes, I think perhaps my approximation was true, that I think AIDS was discovered in the 70s and then it appeared in Malaysia in 86. In year 2000, the Malays had the highest rate of infection. Oh, perhaps this is the connecting point, okay? Because the Malays, we are Muslims, right? The Malays had the highest rate of infection, 69.6% in 2002. In 2000. Followed by Chinese, Indians, Bumiputra or Sabah Sarawak, only 0.5%. And foreigners. Of the total new HIV infection in year 2000, 4.2% were fishermen. And 5.3% were long-distance drivers. So we wonder why these jobs were the ones that had the most cases. The projected cumulative HIV infection in Malaysia for year 2003 is 90,000 cases. Fishermen and long distance drivers. Pity, right? Because we know that typically they are not from the elite class. Okay, if we are talking about class divisions in the society, they are usually, they consist of the lower class. They are from the lower class, right? Long distance drivers, not easy to do that job, right? Very challenging. Also fishermen. The Malays who are infected with HIV AIDS disease in Malaysia are believed to be mainly those already involved in the culture of drug abuse, perhaps this is, of course, okay, one of the reasons. The majority of whom are Malays and of male gender. It may be assumed by the general public that Being Muslims disinfected individuals who have become drug addicts or victims of AIDS should have known that religion Islam strongly prohibits the consumption of intoxicants, including liquor, illicit sex, and fornication of homosexuality. But in the case of HIV, the major modes of transmission other than sexual intercourse are use of contaminated syringes or sharing of unsterilized needles among injecting drug users, infection via birth or nursing from mother to child, reuse of needles in medical settings, and transfusion of contaminated blood or blood products. So these are some of the main ways of the spread, okay, of HIV among the Malay Muslims. Sharing of needles, unsterilized needles when they do drugs. Many young people trapped in the drug abuse or infected by HIV/AIDS disease would not want to be afflicted with such life-threatening epidemics if they had detailed prior knowledge of the grave consequences of their wayward behavior. So according to almarhum Prof, if they knew, okay, if especially the young people, if they knew that they will have grave dangers, then perhaps they will not do it. Moreover, millions of innocent mothers or children or spouses or recipients of infected blood donation who have become helpless victims through no fault of their deserve the greatest attention, treatment, and care. So other innocent people also, they also had to, they also face this infections, right? The Muslim public opinion tends to be highly judgmental and unsympathetic towards adult individuals who believe to have involved themselves knowingly and voluntarily in acts which are well known in Muslim society to be strongly prohibited, such as consumption of alcoholic beverages, premarital, extramarital, or homosexual relations, or sexual relations with prostitutes. So supposedly, we Muslims, we know about this, okay, prohibited acts. But then again, almarhum Prof highlighted here that the Muslim public opinion tends to be highly judgmental and unsympathetic towards those infected patients. Ignorant of the complex nature of modern social ills associated with drugs or sex, or colored by their own perception of the social epidemics, the rush to condemn or not to be associated with those affected by the new disease is understandable. Again, but almarhum Prof said that, but it is understandable why people are behaving like that. Furthermore, the kind of religious education the public is exposed to may be one that overemphasizes the legal aspect of Islam and neglects the spiritual dimension of the religion without any sound understanding of the psychological, cultural, social, economic, and educational factors which influence the formation of the undesirable modes of behavior. All right, so perhaps, okay, we have to look more than the Islamic legal code only, okay, not from the perspective of halal haram only, right? We also, as suggested by almarhum Prof here, we must also look at the psychological, cultural, social, economic, educational perspective, okay, on why people are behaving like that and why people are into this drug abuse. With such an orientation, the scope for compassion, mercy, forgiveness, love, and caring for the unfortunate victims of HIV/AIDS is sadly lacking. Okay, because of this lacking of understanding, because we do not have a proper educational input, perhaps, so we treated these unfortunate victims of HIV badly. Okay, the way of presenting Islam. Okay, this is another subject. Inshallah, okay, this will be the last subtopic before we end today. If not, as I mentioned, the chapter is quite a long chapter. We cannot finish in 1 hour. Okay. Inshallah, this will be the last subtopic that we will discuss today. Anyway, in the meantime, any input that you want to share with us? As I mentioned, I'm from political science, so my view will be mainly from that field. If you have anything that you want to add, perhaps from your own experience, you are most welcome, right? Just switch on your mic and then share with us. I think drug abuse is still dominant today. Say the problem is still everywhere. Okay, the way of presenting Islam. It is useful to reflect here on two types of interpreting Islam as described by a well-known contemporary Islamic religious scholar. In the context of promoting the civilizational mission of Islam for the future well-being of mankind. Okay, what are the two types? The first type is presented in the following way. So almarhum here, he is talking about two types of interpreting Islam. Number one, and he used quotation to describe it. A lot of Muslims have grievously wrong and distorted Islam, which makes it an Arabic version of Western civilization. This is the stand of justifying school, which tries to grant legitimacy to the status quo which the West has created in our countries. So that is the first version, which is the Arabic version of Western civilization. Okay. The second type is characterized as follows. Contrary to this stand, there are some people who introduce Islam in a way which make our flesh quiver, limbs tremble, and hearts are tremulated. They introduce Islam as fatalism of creed, formalism of worship, passivity of conduct, superficiality of thinking, literalism of explanation, zahirism of fiqh, and pompousness of life. All right. So this is quite a literal take on Islam. Okay, I think formalism, literalism, zahirism on the surface only. So this type of Islam is a frowning and scowling Islam which knows nothing but violence in call. They simply want to punish halal haram, then punish. Harshness in argumentation, roughness in treatment, and rudeness in conduct. Not only harshness, but actually they themselves are rude people, according to almarhum. Okay? Moreover, those people say that Islam is nothing but legislation, and legislation is nothing but punishment. Only talking about punish here, punish there. All right? It is Islam which neither knows tolerance with those of different religions, dialogue with opponents in ideology, nor opposition in politics. So they do not tend to talk, but actually they tend to, they are the intolerance, okay, towards different religions other than Islam. Okay, I think this is the connecting point with the previous chapters. So here our marhum prof is trying to say that this kind of Islam is not good. Okay, Islam that does not tolerate different religions, does not dialogue. Tolerate meaning to say not to accept. Okay, it is Islam which looks at women with doubt, always have su'uzon with women. Perhaps it calls for her confinement in home, depriving them, okay, women from work and participating in all activities and social life. This Islam also deprives women here, women her right in voting, not to mention her nomination for different offices. Women should not contest, should not be the candidates for election. It is Islam which does not care about justice in distribution of wealth, doesn't care how much women should get, nor enforce the principle of consultation or shura in politics. Okay, they don't consult women when it comes to women affairs, when they produce, I mean they, the government, when the government produces policies related to women, supposedly they should invite women to talk. No recognized freedom for people, no inquire thieves about what they had committed. But again, of course, within limitation, right? Rather, it is Islam that occupies the minds of people with controversy on subsidiary and secondary matters of fiqh, as well as disputatious texts concerning rituals and transactions, simply merely focusing on rituals. So this kind of Islam is not good, according to Almarhum. Okay, it is Islam that enlarges the prohibition zone. Okay, talking about to prohibit here and there, to the extent that life seems as if it is a group of prohibitions, and the nearest word on the tongues of its scholars and pens of its writers is unlawful or haram. Okay, haram here, haram there. This interpretation of Islam, which is black and gloomy, is no doubt introduced by Muslims who may be sincere in their intentions but have no sound understanding. Okay, actually there are people that, sorry to say, are not that knowledgeable, okay, but they claim to be, will not be able to play, will not be able to play the role of alternative civilization of the future. Okay. The desirable and authenticity images of Islam, the Islam of the Quran and Sunnah, and the rightly guided caliphs. It is Islam of easiness, not difficulty. So this should be the one, okay, as highlighted by Almarhum here. Islam should be of easiness, not difficulty, glad tidings, not repulsion, kindness, not violence, familiarization, not aversion, tolerance, not fanaticism, not ta'assub, essence, not appearance, work, not controversy, giving, not pretension, creativity, not imitation, not taqlid, renewal, not stagnation, discipline, not looseness, taqlid, blind taqlid. Okay. Discipline, not looseness, and moderation, not excessiveness, nor negligence. Okay. So here again, the word moderation appears. Hence the title of the book. Okay, so this is the last quote before we end. Okay. Because as I mentioned, the next subtopic from apathy to compassion is quite long. So we will continue, inshallah, in the next session. It is Islam which is founded on creed, whose spirit is monotheism, a worship whose spirit is sincerity, a morality whose spirit is benevolence, a sharia whose spirit is justice, a bond whose spirit is brotherhood. And the fruit of all this is a civilization whose spirit is balance and integrity. So only through this then we will have a balanced civilization and we will have justice. So footnote number 12, I will look at, actually almarhum is quoting from who? Number 12. Ibid. Oh, from Yusuf Al-Qaradawi. Okay. Islam, the future civilization. So as he mentions, he is quoting from a scholar. Actually, the scholar is Yusuf Al-Qaradawi. Okay, alhamdulillah, we have finished reading for today's session. Anyone wants to share anything about AIDS, HIV, about... Okay, we actually, at Centris, we conducted so far 2 webinars on gender dysphoria. Gender dysphoria is about people who are confused here and there about their gender identity, and therefore later it relates to the question of AIDS. And therefore, as I mentioned, the question of the pill, the pre-exposure prophylaxis pills or PrEP pills. All right, now it is available. The question right now is whether doctors should prescribe that. Okay, so we discuss about that. Okay, to especially when it comes to the people who abuse these pills for their own, okay, to help them help when they do illicit activities, okay, especially homosexuality, right, LGBTQ plus. So this PrEP actually manages to reduce the possibility of them from getting HIV. So that's why, right? But that is the current issue. Maybe, of course, inshallah, Centris is publishing a book on gender dysphoria. We combine here lecturers from RKCS, AHAS, RKCS, and also from laws, from economics, combined with like doctors from Kuantan's campus. Okay, because lecturers there, they feel that, okay, they need additional force to combat these problems, not simply by giving them medical advice, but also they feel, the doctors there, they feel that we need also inputs from human sciences or religious perspective, okay, to combat this issue of LGBTQ, alright? Because these people, they are clever people, okay? People who support, especially, for example, professors outside who support LGBTQs, they are clever people, right? So we are, okay, our humble attempt here is to produce a book, an academic book, to counter their arguments on why we should not go for gay, lesbian, queer, etc. Okay, anyone wants to share anything on whatever that we have discussed just now? Some of my students also are joining. Masturina, you want to say anything?
Doctor.
Ah.
May I know if countries that that have huge number of LGBTQ, right? Does the HIV case increase as well?
Countries that
Countries that have huge people with LGBTQ.
oh
Yeah.
yeah, of course, that's why, all right, as mentioned. But yeah, my student, of course, she will ask question. I ask for sharing. Okay, this is a book reading session, by the way. You can share whatever that you want to share, not necessarily a question, because I'm not really an expert in this medical field. But as far as I'm concerned, I think thank you, by the way, Mas Surina. I think because of the perhaps misuse of that needles, okay, unsterilized needles, how they shared freely with one another, therefore they got infected. Or maybe because of the, because as mentioned in what we have read just now by Almarhum Prof, the highest number is actually from developing countries, all right, not from those advanced countries. But that was the data in 2002, okay, not now. But as we know, advanced countries are those countries that started to allow the practice of LGBTQ plus plus. So we can see the paradox here. Why they do not have the highest number? Maybe because of the population again, just like as highlighted by Masturina. Because this thing is, okay, if we do not take care of our lifestyle, then it can spread, okay, quickly. All right. So maybe that's why in developing or poor countries, we have more cases. Maybe not because of homosexuality, maybe because of illicit sex, right? Practice, even though they have a lower rate of LGBTQ, but they practice free sex. Therefore, that's how they got infected. Maybe that's my humble opinion. Maybe any other thing, Arshad, you want to add anything? I saw Arshad now.
No, sir. I'm just curious. When we try to counter the LGBTQ, the pro-LGBTQ people, like regardless of it, whether they are academicians or them being part of it, how do we do that when most of them just are on the basis of emotional, not really rational? I mean, like we can try to put forward the points, the facts, maybe about HIV/AIDS, where the statistics of diseases are very alarming. But then when, I mean, they are so pro that they just ignore the facts. And when you say something that is true and valid, they would just like, well, we don't care, or maybe they would turn to other facts like, okay, HIV is not because of LGBTQ, it's for other reasons, so it's not about our lifestyle. So how do we actually counter that?
Yeah, that's true. All right. We only can advise as much as we could, but they themselves actually, they are the ones that if they want to change, they will change. All right. If not, then we cannot force them. We can only do the da'wah, but it's up to them to accept it or not. And of course, it's up to Allah to give them hidayah or not, right? Yeah, that's true, Ashad. We can give them all of this. We can go up to the most logical answers or arguments. But then, if they still do not want to accept, then what to do, right? But at least we try. We have to try, because in as far as I'm concerned, okay, the project on, for example, gender dysphoria by the Kuantan team by Prof. Samsul Draman, okay, they managed. It's already 11 years right now. They did that. They managed to revert, okay, those, I think, more than 10 maknyah, right? Reverted back. They already done the, okay, the plastic surgery here and there. But Alhamdulillah, okay, even they said there from bapa ayam to nasi ayam, okay. So the person went to Hajj. I think IUMs provided them the fund, okay, for them to go to Hajj or Umrah, something between Umrah or Hajj. But then they came back, they reverted, okay, totally changed, got married, all right? Got married with normal marriage, right, between man and woman. So yes, some cases did success stories. We've got some success stories, but again, it is very challenging because, as I mentioned, these people, they are clever people. Okay, not easy to argue with them, right? But at least we try. Okay. Thank you, Ashad. Anyone anymore want to say anything? Okay. All right. So Alhamdulillah. So inshallah, all right, we will continue the session every third Friday. Every third Friday of the month, we will do the book on Wasatia. Every first Friday, I will read the book on corruption by Al-Mahrum Profs too, right? The red book, red in color book. The second Friday, Dr. Jannah will read the book on on Kalam Suci. Okay, Kalam Suci is a collection of poem written by Almarhum Prof. And the fourth week, Dr. Jannah also will read again, but not from the Kalam Suci book, from the natural sciences, from the Islamic, from the Quranic perspective. All right, so every Friday we will have this session Friday evening. So all of you again are welcome. So thank you again for coming, for your participation. It is very much appreciated. All right, we end our session with Tasbih Kafarah and Suratul Asr. Okay, thank you everyone.
Thank you so
thank
much.
Thank you, Doctor.
Thank you.